Welcome to Raye Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scripture.
Start off today a little bit differently. I'm going to read a few verses from the Parsha, and then James Head is going to come and do traditionally what's called a drash, which is a short teaching on the Torah portion, and then I'm going to follow that up with the regular teaching. So we are in Exodus chapter 18, if you want to look in your Bible, and I have the slides up there. And actually, do we have a pointer for someone to point at the Hebrew? Because Ben isn't here, but Aaron, maybe you can do that. And we are in Exodus chapter 18, verses 21 through 23. This is at the visit of Yitro in the Hebrew, or Jethro in the English, that Moses' father-in-law paid to him after the people got out of Egypt and were just about come to Mount Sinai. So we're starting in verse 21 there. Ve'ata tekezeh, and you shall choose, mikol ha'am, from amongst all the people, aneshei chayil, that's men who are competent, yiru Elohim, who fear God, aneshei emet, men of truth, senai who hate evil, v'simta, and you shall appoint aleihem, you shall appoint them, sarei elafim, leaders of thousands, sarei ma'ot, leaders of hundreds, sarei chamishim, leaders of fifties, v'sarei esarot, and leaders of ten. V'shaftu, and they shall judge, et ha'am, the people, b'kol eit, on every dispute. V'hayat, it shall be, b'kol hadavar hagadol, in every large matter, yivu elecha, they shall bring to you, that is to Moses, and v'kol hadavar hakatan, and for every small matter, yishpatu chem, they shall judge. V'chakol, and then you shall stand amongst them, me'alecha, v'nesua, and they shall bear the burden with you. Atech im Atecha, I'm sorry, shall be the burden with you, atecha, that's venasu atecha, and they shall bear the burden with you. Im et the zivar, and if you shall do this, hazeh, ta'ase yitzva Elohim, as commands the Lord, ye v'chlot amod, you shall be able to stand, v'gam kol ha'am, and also the people, hazeh, these people, al mikomo, to the place they are going, yavo b'shalom, they shall go in peace. Amen.
Thank you. It seems kind of boring, but this is like a really interesting thing that happens. I don't know if you guys can hear me. In the time right after the children of Israel leave Egypt. I'm going to stop and say one other thing, is that the name of this Parsha, right, is Yitro, right? Jethro. It's the name of a man. He happens to be Moshe or Moses' father-in-law. I don't even think he's Jewish. He's of a different ethnicity. And it covers chapters 18, 19, and 20 of the book of Exodus. And very famously, chapter 20 is the Ten Commandments, right? It's the Torah. It's what this entire collection of books is called. It's named after this one piece right here, the Torah. And so I just find it really interesting that as people gather together and put these reading portions, that as we get into it later, the Ten Commandments wasn't given first billing as the start of a parsha, right? It wasn't called the Torah, right? That's not the reading. It's Yitro, and I think it's an interesting bookend that God is concerned in His people. It's not about His laws as much as these laws are for us. And here we are, a fantastic example of the people trying to figure out how to relate to each other and how to solve problems. I think very specifically, Yitro was trying to help Moses live. and he gives him some really good advice. He's like, listen, there's no way that you're going to help everybody figure out their dispute by yourself. And so you need to take, if you go back, it says, we didn't include this part. He goes, what is this that you're doing to the people? Why do you sit there alone with all the people standing around you from morning till evening? What I find interesting is that the most important part of the advice is not specifically that we're going to settle disputes, but rather you need to find holy people, right, that are going to be involved in these people's lives. God-fearing people, incorruptible people. And so the first question is, how do you know that these people are holy? You get to know them. And I know that this is specifically about solving disputes, but this is all about caring for the children of Israel, caring about them. And I mean, you got to remember, they still had the slavery mindset. They had just come out of slavery, so they were very worried, and there was a lot of conflict because they had lived in a life where, you know, you didn't know if you were going to get enough to eat, and so dispute was the first thing that was happening. But you got to remember that this the setup didn't change, it didn't stop. And they wandered for a long time, for 40 years. And so as the holy men, I should say, that Yitro and Moses selected to care for these smaller and smaller segments of God's people, they got old, they passed away. And so the question is, where did the new godly people come from? Well, they came from this system, right? And so I wish I had made a PowerPoint slide or something, but I just find it interesting that they came from Egypt, and the biggest symbol that we think of in Egypt is this pyramid, and there's still pyramids today. I mean, there's many corporations and companies and governments where you've got this person on the top, and they're supported by some people, and they're supported, but really what's happening is they're big, heavy blocks, and so all the weight is pushing down onto the little folk at the bottom. and that's the pyramid scheme, right? That all the little folks support the burden. And what I believe is happening here is that the shape is staying the same, but Yitro and Moses are setting up a root system. If you think about a tree, the roots spread out, and if you looked at, if somehow we remove the dirt, the roots actually are kind of in the same triangle shape. They get bigger at the bottom, but it's the other way. Everything's going up. And so we have these families of these people, 10 people, and there's someone there that looks after them and knows their life inside and out. And then there's hundreds. And so what is really happening here is that Moses and Yitro has put people in place that are looking after small groups and then letting them know what's happening in these people's lives. And so the last thing I want to say is that we're trying to get that happening here at Shema. So here's the the punchline is that we're trying to build these Havara groups, which mean community, for the same exact purpose. As we want small groups of people to get together so we can know you and you guys can know each other. And then if not even just a dispute, don't worry about arguments. What if you're just having a problem in life? There's no way that the elders and rabbi are going to know everything is happening in your life unless there's other people advocating for you, caring about you and letting them know, listen, I saw that this person was having a hard time this week, and let's keep them in prayer. And so it's this reverse pyramid. It's the same shape, but everything's going up instead of being pressed down. And I think that's what happened here. So, yeah, Yitro is a pretty wise man. At the end, he throws in, God's saying that you should do this. But I think a lot of the wisdom came from him. And there's no mention of this system being thrown away. And so you got to remember that this kept them moving and kept them living and kept them alive for many years as they made it into the promised land. So hopefully I didn't go too long. All right. Thank you.
So everybody's probably thinking, is he still going to tell a joke? I am. And I have to give credit to this for this one to an old friend of many of ours whose humor and very, very wry sense of humor we all miss. How many miss Claude Painter's humor? Yes. So this is called A Homeless Man's Funeral, and it's from Claude. As a bagpiper, I play many gigs. Recently, I was asked by a funeral director to play at a graveside service for a homeless man. He had no family or friends, so the service was to be at a pauper cemetery in the Kentucky backcountry. As I was not familiar with the backwoods, I got lost. And being a typical man, I didn't stop for directions. I finally arrived an hour late and saw that the funeral guy had evidently gone, and the hearse was nowhere in sight. There were only the diggers and the crew left, and they were eating lunch. I felt badly and apologized to the men for being late, and I went to the side of the grave and looked down, and the vault lid was already in place. I didn't know what else to do, so I started to play my bagpipes. The workers put down their lunches and began to gather around. I played out my heart and soul for this man with no family and friends. I played Amazing Grace. The workers began to weep. They wept. I wept. We all wept together. When I finished, I packed up my bagpipes and started for my car. Though my head hung low, my heart was full. And as I opened the door to my car, I heard one of the workers say, I've never seen anything like that before, and I've been putting in septic tanks for 20 years. And the final line was, apparently I'm still lost. So I want to start out today with some further confirmations that the Lord has given on this series of messages that we have been getting over the past few weeks. There was the ones that Rabbi Ben and I received down at the Rabbis Conference, and then each of us gave a message about discipleship. And I got a couple of more confirmations. Of course, James asked this week, we were looking at the Parsha and saying, when the Parsha for Yitro comes up, I want to talk about Chavurah groups, which are discipling mechanisms, and that all completely fit into this whole thing. But let's just take a minute and pray first. So, Father, we just thank you for your word and the encouragement of it, and we lift it up to you right now, and we pray for you to open our hearts, open the gates of our hearts, Father, as we prayed before, to what your word has to say to us. In Yeshua's name, amen. Microphone just went, there it comes. If you weren't here last week, I want to encourage you to listen to Rabbi Ben's message. It's up on the podcast. And he had two really significant insights. First of all, that Israel, the deliverance of Israel from slavery in Egypt is kind of a parallel or a type of what a person goes through when they first come to believe in the Lord. They're set free from the bondage of sin, and now they are to walk out their ways of the Lord. So it's the time after coming out of Egypt is like the discipling time that God had the people in the desert. And what Rabbi Ben pointed out that I thought was so insightful was that if you could imagine after they got out from Egypt, if Moses and God had left the people on their own after that, what would have happened? Either they would have died in the desert or they would have gone back to Egypt, right? And so we see that parallel in people who begin to come to the Lord. What would happen if we just leave them on their own? They will either die or go back to Egypt. And the second insight was based on one of my favorite verses in John chapter 15. Yeshua says this, "You did not choose me, I chose you, and I have commissioned you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last." So I've taught on this a lot of times before, that there's an internal fruit, the fruit of the Spirit, but there's also external fruit that each of us bear, and that is the fruit of other people that we bring into the kingdom of God or disciple on their walk in the kingdom of God. So how do we bear fruit that lasts, external fruit? And Rabbi Ben pointed out, I thought it was really interesting since he is a chef. He pointed out, if you remember, that if you try to keep fruit for very long, what happens to it? It goes bad. There's no way you can keep fruit and make it last forever. So how can you bear fruit that lasts forever? The only way to do it is to create fruit that reproduces. So the fruit that you bear, in order for it to last forever, has to have within it the ability and the vision and the direction to bear fruit themselves. In other words, bring more people along and disciple more people. So that was to me just a powerful insight. I just wanted to reiterate it here today so that we all can really digest it. Bad pun. But then I had this another amazing confirmation this week. I was thinking and reading about the Israeli elections, and I was very confused about what actually was going to come out of this. And I read a note from Joel Rosenberg. And some of you know who Joel is. He's a very, very famous author. He's written many, many New York Times bestsellers that are all they're political thrillers, and they're set in the future. So it's like he takes the prophecies in the Bible and he says, you know, what if this was going to be happening? And he writes novels about these things. And Joel said that he was going to discuss this topic in an interview that was on YouTube. So I checked it out, and he was being interviewed, and he talked for about 45 minutes about the topic, which I was interested in, about the situation in Israel and the Middle East and all of the complications and how the United States could respond. And the interviewer, a pastor who was interviewing him, asked him, well, what can we as believers do in this situation? We're facing all that complication in the Middle East, and we're facing the moral decay in our own country here. What can we do? And Joel responded, as I'm sure many of you respond, says, we need revival here in America. How many agree with that? Yes. But then he just turned and he said, but what I see is that Americans in our McDonald's, Burger King mentality, fast food drive-through mentality, we want a quick fix. We want God to come down and just somehow supernaturally touch everybody so that there will be this incredible revival here, right? That's what we all want, right? And Joel saying, I don't think that's going to how it's going to happen. I don't think that's the way it works. I think what is going to happen, the only way it's going to happen, is if each of us disciple a few people who disciple a few people. And my mouth just dropped open. It was like, another message on this from the Lord? And that was his message, was that the only way that the fruit will remain, that it won't just be a quick thing. Like if some of you remember when 9/11 happened, there was this big supposed turning in this country. Everybody became very spiritual suddenly, was singing God Bless America, and attendance at churches and synagogues suddenly grew tremendously for a couple of weeks, right? And then it just went back to normal. So he ended the interview with a very interesting scenario of each of us coming before the judgment seat of the Messiah. You know, there's a judgment where our works will be judged. And Yeshua simply looking at each of us and saying, glad that you're here. Where are your disciples? and people saying things like, oh, I didn't know I was supposed to do that. So that was another very amazing confirmation. So the other confirmation was that as I was praying about what I talked about a couple of weeks ago, was that this whole concept of that we must make disciples who make disciples. And I did some miraculous arithmetic, if you remember, last week. And I don't know how many of you agreed with that arithmetic, or 2 weeks ago, that if we just, each of us made like 4 disciples a year or 2 disciples a year, there would be this enormous growth in a very short time. And as I was thinking about this week, I began to see that there was actually something in the scriptures that showed that this actually happened. Now, the first thing to understand is that, you know, a spiritual generation is not like a physical generation. And we get the idea of where a spiritual generation is from the life of Yeshua. He began his ministry and began teaching his disciples 3 years before he left this world. So that's kind of how long it takes to disciple someone and get them ready to do what you've been doing, which is what they did, right? So in 3 years, there was a new spiritual generation. It could be longer, could be shorter, but that's just an idea. So Yeshua discipled 12, and we know that there were 120 in the upper room who were believers. We don't know that they were as well discipled as the 12, but there was at least 120. And I just had this amazing confirmation of, you know, the way this multiplies. In Acts chapter 21, Paul, who has gone out to the cities of the Roman Empire to bring the good news to the people in those cities, comes back to Jerusalem, and he gives a report. And the leaders in Jerusalem also give a report back to Rabbi Shaul, or Paul. And this is in Acts 21 and verse 20. On hearing it, that's the report that Paul gave, they praised God for it. But they also said to him, "You see, brother, how many tens of thousands of believers there are among the Judeans, among the Jewish people in Jerusalem, and they're all zealous for the Torah." So this took place. I looked it up how long this was. This was about 30 years after Yeshua left this world. And what we see is that there were, in the terminology of this verse, many tens of thousands in 30 years. So what does this mean? What does many mean? I mean, you got a couple or a few, so it's got to be more than three tens of thousands, or it would say a few tens of thousands. Maybe it's four or five. 50,000, let's say. 50,000 believers from 120 in 30 years. How did that happen? I believe it was the same process, the same multiplication process that I talked about a couple of weeks ago. So, today I want to move on and talk a little bit more about discipling. And I want to start out with responding to what some of you who are a little older might warn us about this. Because back in 1970s, there was a strong discipling movement. And some of you have heard of this. It was called the Shepherding Movement. And some of these names, maybe some of you have heard Bob Munford, Ern Baxter, Don Basham. If you haven't heard those names, they wrote books and they spoke in lots of places. And the movement was born out of a desire by pastors to be accountable to someone. And it resulted in a large network of people submitting to each other for accountability and for discipleship. But what happened was, over the years, that it went overboard. And the doctrines became very authoritarian, demanding people's submission to whoever was discipling them in all areas of life. So people were coming and asking for, you know, direction from their discipler in, you know, what should I buy at the grocery store this week, or what kind of car should I buy, and all kinds of things. It got totally out of hand, and it even got to the point where the disciplers were claiming greater authority than this in a person's life, that they could have that authority. And so after a few years of this, the error was exposed by some leaders in the body. Pat Robertson was one of them. And the network fell apart under this exposure. And some of these men, Bob Munford, Derek Prince, Charles Simpson, they publicly repented and changed their direction. So I want to just say, before we go any further in saying that we're going to be emphasizing this, that we're not going down that road. Okay, that's not what we're talking about. We will learn from the people in the past who went overboard, but we won't throw out the baby with the bathwater. Because discipling, as any of you have read the Bible, you know this is the heart of what Yeshua commanded us to do. And we can't shy away from it because somebody made some mistakes. And so I had a clear understanding of, for me, how to avoid this pitfall. And it comes out of Galatians chapter 4 and verse 19. And here Rabbi Shaul is speaking to the people in Galatia, and he says this. He says, "My dear children, I am suffering the pains of giving birth to you all over again. And this will go on until the Messiah takes shape in you or is formed in you." So what's this all about? Well, Shaul was suffering these pains because those whom he had given birth to spiritually, the people in Galatia, had fallen into error. And he was he was experiencing the pain of that. And I can tell you, I have experienced that pain, and maybe some of you had, when somebody that you're working with who's a new believer, they're in that process of learning to follow the Spirit of God, and sometimes they miss. And they suffer the consequences of their missing. And I can tell you, I suffer with them when that happens. So Paul is saying, you guys have messed up. And if you read the book of Galatians, it's about them messing up. And I'm suffering before that. But what did he mean by, I'm going to continue to suffer until the Messiah takes shape or is formed in you? And what that means to me is that in Romans chapter 8, in verse 14, it says this, all who are led by God's Spirit are God's sons and God's daughters, of course. So what the scriptures teach us is that we are all of us, to learn to be led ourselves by the Spirit of God. And until Messiah takes shape in you, to me that means until you become enough like the Messiah, until his presence in you is strong enough that you're able to follow the Holy Spirit on your own without having to have somebody coach you in it all the time. And I believe that is possible. So my goal as a discipler, and I want it to be your goal too, is not to make people dependent on me for direction so that they have to come to me. I mean, it really does boost your ego when somebody comes to you and says, oh, I need to know how to do this. Please, you have all the wisdom. You tell me. But it's not what I want. And people will do that at times, you know, if they need it, and it's okay. But it's not what I believe God is calling us to do as we disciple people. We're to teach people to follow the Spirit themselves. And that's totally opposite to what that shepherding movement got into. It was it's an easy trap to fall into. But I believe that every one of us can follow the Spirit of God ourselves, and that he will give us that wisdom directly from the Lord for our walk, for all the things that God calls us to do. We are capable of that. Now, we will make mistakes at times, but we will learn as we go along to follow the Spirit more and more. And then I started to think about this in terms of the historical context of this verse in Galatians. And I realized that, you know, that shepherding movement, it is really I think it could only be a modern construct. I don't think this could have happened back then. Because if you think about this, with modern communication, it is possible for people to check with each other all the time, right? Even in distant locations, if you have somebody that you look up to, you know, you can call on the phone, you can text, you can send an email, and you can get their advice. So it's not impossible to be related like that. But think about this in Rabbi Shaul's time. None of that existed. I don't even know if there was snail mail back then in the Roman Empire. Could you just like write a letter and post it and say, here, deliver this, kid? Just somebody, yeah, okay. Well, it probably took months, right? And I need to have a decision by tomorrow. and I got to send out this letter. So it really didn't even work. So in the case of Rabbi Shaul, he would go and plant a congregation. He'd disciple the leaders. He'd put them in place, and he would leave. And what would he do? He would trust them to be able to hear from the Holy Spirit themselves. And they could not possibly have consulted him. So something like what happened in the 70s, you see what I'm saying? It couldn't have happened in the first century. There was no way. So I believe that's what God has in mind for us here. So when I start getting into this whole process about you guys making disciples, how do you learn to disciple others? It's very simple. You must be discipled yourself. That's how you learn. You then impart what has been imparted to you. And I just tell you the story. In my life, I had, at different periods of time, many different people who discipled me. When Diane and I first came to the Lord, our next-door neighbors were our disciplers, Doug and Gloria. And they discipled us in the ways of a new believer, how we were to change our lives. They discipled us in how to study the Bible. And we had kids the same age, and our kids, we were not doing a great job on, but they had the Lord's wisdom, and they discipled us on how to raise our children. And then soon after that, I met a guy at work who was a strong and mature believer. His name was Carl Massidi, and he discipled me at work. We used to get together at lunchtime all the time, and we'd pray for people. He taught me how to be a witness at work, and he was the one that began to teach me about the gifts of the Spirit and the supernatural aspect, because Doug and Glory were not too big on that. But so he discipled me in that, and then another another friend of mine at work that I've introduced to some of you, Pat Capiello, he's an incredible evangelist. He would just meet people all over the place, walking down the halls of Xerox and working with them, and would be sharing with them all the time. And I just hung out with him. He didn't put me through any training, but that was the training. Hanging out with him was incredible training to see what you could do in that. And also in prayer. He's a great warrior in prayer. And then we became part of a New Covenant Fellowship in Penfield. And I particularly connected with Pastor George Osborne, who's still a good friend of mine, now leads a congregation out in Ontario. And it was really George who taught me to teach. He was the model for me of how to teach the Bible. He also taught me to pastor. And George and his wife, Betsy, and his family, they modeled for Diane and I a godly family life. So there was all that discipling going on. And then I came here. And Jonathan, of course, was someone who discipled me. I didn't really know that much about the Messianic vision and what the Messianic movement was all about. So Jonathan mentored me in that. And also, I'd never met anybody, and I'm sure probably never none of you have met anybody, who has the vision that Jonathan has to go out and do things that are beyond imagination because the Lord calls him to do those things. He's still doing things like that if you follow what he's doing these days. And then David Levine came on. And David Levine mentored me in leading and in counseling and teaching and in pastoring. So I look back and I can see all of these people who discipled me. And every one of them, it was different. Every one of them was like on a different area. And it was at a different time. But it was almost like, sometimes I used to say, well, you know, I'm going through the school of the Spirit and we're starting a new semester here. And this is what it's going to be on. And it was like God was just leading me in that way. So who can you disciple? Well, I believe you can disciple anyone who has less experience than you do. Okay? Less experience than you do. And it can be in specific areas of your life that you have expertise in. You can disciple in areas of your expertise. Now, that person might have more experience in some other area, but you can lead them and train them in the area that you have expertise in. Two people can, in fact, mutually disciple each other. And in fact, Jonathan and I actually had that kind of a relationship because when Jonathan came here, he was 24, I think just out of college, and I was 40. And he discipled me in the things that I mentioned, but I believe he learned a lot from me in observing my family life and how to work with people. And in fact, one of the most interesting things was we did something here called Evangelism Explosion, where we went out and knocked on doors and shared the gospel. And that's how Jonathan learned to share the gospel. Really, I listen to him when he gives the gospel message at the festivals, and he still uses the same format. It's amazing. But some of you remember Dorothy Benzoni? Remember Dorothy? She trained Jonathan. It was a discipling program where each person took two other people with them and taught them how to share the good news. And Dorothy took Jonathan, and so you know we're doing this mutual back and forth kind of thing. So it's in your area of expertise that you will attract potential disciples, and so we have that happening right here. Carl's area of expertise is finances, so he's doing a Chavura group right now. And the subject that they're studying is how to deal with our personal finances. That's discipling. Judith's area of expertise is prayer. And she disciples people who come alongside her and join her in prayer. Aaron and Ethel and Hannah and are worship leaders. And so when people come alongside them and begin to work with them, they disciple people in worship leading, but also in the thing to see here is that the discipling also happens in all areas of life. Jane and Shea are dancers, and so they disciple people in through the dancing process. Meryl and James and Stacy, Jerry, Jill all lead Chavura groups. I don't know if I missed anybody. Bob, they lead Chavura groups, and through those groups, they teach the Bible, might be their area of expertise, or it might be bringing people into fellowship, making them feel comfortable. They learn these things, and then they impart that to other things. Elizabeth leads people in how to run a bookstore right now. And Ben and Andrea, I've seen they do a lot in with people in helping them with their marriage, in helping them with raising their kids. So these are the areas of expertise. So let's talk a little about now about how to disciple. We talked about who, but how do we disciple? And the instruction given to Moses by Yitro in the previous verses from what we just read, you can see how you are to disciple from those verses. So I'm going to read to you verses 18 and 19. This is what Yitro said to Moses. So listen now to what I have to say. I will give you some advice, and God will be with you. You should represent the people before God, and you should bring their cases to God. So that's the first instruction for discipling somebody. Do you see what it is? Pray for them, right? Don't even think about discipling people if you're not going to pray for them. Start by praying for them. That's the priestly role. Verse 20, you should also teach them the laws and the teachings and show them how to live their lives and what work they should do. So this is the kind of the prophetic role of the discipler. He's to teach God's word to his disciples. So if you're discipling someone about their finances, and I know that Carl, you do it this way, there's like the godly principles about finances, right? If you're discipling something about dancing, it's, you know, how dancing can be a way of worshiping God. You bring in the godly things about this. So that's the teaching, the actual speaking it out. But then it says this very interesting phrase, show them, and it's a different Hebrew word from the teach, show them how to live their lives. What does that mean? That means be an example before them. Live your life before them so that they learn from the example rather than from the words. That's the mentoring role, demonstrating, having them do what you do and then coaching them, correcting them, giving them help as to how to do it better. And in all of these areas, like the areas of ministry, this is how this showing works. In the area of hospitality, that's how the Shabbat groups work, right? You taught the people who were how to be hospitable, how to welcome people in. In the area of compassion, that's what we do in our sharing our bread ministry. We help needy people. So we show people to how to be compassionate and to serve. In the area of evangelism and prayer and worship and in study, all of those things, you demonstrate to people how to do it. And then finally, there's this, show them what work they should do. And this is also a little bit different from teaching or living before them. This is actually giving them direction for organized things to do to help advance the kingdom of God. Having vision, like if you're leading a chavurah group, having vision for that group as to what they should accomplish rather than just, okay, it's great that we're going to hang out together and we're all going to grow in the word, but should we do anything? Is there some things that we should do, some strategies? Should we organize something? Should we follow up on people? Should we reach out to people? Those are the things that a discipler leads his disciples to do. So this is how it's worked for me. I work with the congregation leaders on the work of this ministry. But what happens is, and those of you who meet with me privately know, is that when we meet privately about the work of the ministry, we often deal with the word about something. Well, what does the Bible say about this? And how to walk with God, and oftentimes personal issues come up. And we pray for those personal issues that people have. So those relationships, they're more than what it would be, you know, in industry where you get you meet with your boss and he tells you what to do and you talk about your problems and it's all about work. But this is bigger than that because it's also a discipling relationship. But also, in my week, I lead four groups that meet periodically, where I teach or demonstrate in the areas of my expertise. So I teach a leadership group. A leadership group, our leaders meet once a month. I teach the Messianic Judaism group about what Messianic Judaism is about. At the Benafshi group, or the For My Life group, that's about healing. And the Sharing Our Bread group is about serving the needy. So the people who participate in those groups get discipled in those areas, as well as they connect with me in other areas of their lives. So how can, we said earlier that in order to disciple, you have to be discipled. Well, how can you find someone to disciple you? That's always a question. Very simple. Ask the Holy Spirit. Ask the Holy Spirit to show you someone you can learn from. And here's the hard part. Humble yourself and be teachable. Humble yourself and say, you know, here's the way that it usually works. I'd like to help you with what you're doing. And usually then that person will welcome you to help, because oftentimes the person who's doing something that you want to learn how to do, is too busy to just say, well, okay, let's meet together for a couple hours and I'll tell you how to do this. You say, well, is there some way I can help you to do that, take the load off of your hands, and then you can learn what that person is doing. This is a very biblical principle. How did Moses disciple Joshua? He helped him. And we have several other examples in the Bible. Elisha, it says he washed the hands of Elijah. What does that mean? He was his servant. And then, of course, the 12. The 12 didn't just hang out with Yeshua, but he assigned them things to do. They helped him, and he discipled them. And I had a really interesting experience with this in my life. It goes back to the time when I was part of a Covenant Life Fellowship, George Osborne. And George had led a home group for many years, and Diane and I always went to that home group. It was the place where we learned and we were discipled. And then George, at that time, was the assistant pastor at New Covenant Fellowship. But then he went off to start Covenant Life Fellowship, and he stopped leading that home group, and he turned it over to another gentleman named Steve Douglas. And the group met in Steve Douglas's house. And so we were there, and months went by, and we were part of that fellowship. And the congregation decided that they needed to appoint deacons. And so I had been very much, you know, like I am about the word. I contributed a lot to the discussions, and I would talk a lot, or you know, and give insight in our Bible study times. And I thought, well, you know, it's going to be me. It's going to be me that gets appointed to this, right? And Steve was very quiet, very, very quiet. He did teach, but he was very quiet. His teachings weren't great. But Steve used to help George take the trash to the dump. And I remember hearing about this. They would say, oh, you know, we'll meet Wednesday and we'll take the trash to the dump. And guess who got to be appointed a deacon? Steve. And it was a real lesson to me that the relationship was more important than the performance, is basically what it was. George trusted Steve more than he trusted me. He could see the faithfulness in Steve more than he could see it in me. And so it was that same thing. You help someone and they can see this in you. So let's get back to this this role of teaching God's word as a discipler. And I want to just read to you again the Great Commission in Matthew. Yeshua came and talked to them with them, and he said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make people from all nations into Talmudim, or disciples, immersing them into the reality of the Father, the Son, and the Ruach HaKodesh, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I will be with you always, yes, even until the end of the age. So from this, we can see that the process of disciple making is given right there. Can you see what it is? Teach them to obey everything Yeshua commanded you. This is the heart of it. And he promised us his power and his authority to accomplish this path. And really, it's the same thing that Yitro told Moses, right? Teach them the things of the Lord. Teach them to obey the words of the Lord. So let's take a look now in the few minutes that we have left here at some of the things that Yeshua commanded us to do. And as James pointed out, coincidentally, the last chapter of this parsha is what is known as the Ten Commandments. And you may be thinking, well, that's not something Yeshua told us to do. He wasn't even around then. But if you believe the Bible like I do, and believe that Yeshua is God himself come as a man, then all the commands in the Old Testament were given by him. So it is his word. So I'm going to just take a look at those commands. And what I find very, very important to understand is that many places in the New Covenant, Yeshua is giving us his interpretation of what the commands in the Old Covenant were. He's giving us insight on how to obey them. So let's just today, we don't have a lot of time, we're just going to look at the first one in the Ten Commandments. But I believe the Lord's saying to go through all of them over the next few weeks. Exodus chapter 20, verse 1, then God said all these words, I am Adonai, the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the abode of slavery. Now, in Judaism, the Ten Commandments are actually called Esar Devarot, the Ten Words. They're not called the Ten Commandments. And the reason for that is that in Judaism, this is considered the first word. And if you know anything about grammar, is it a commandment? No. It's just a statement. It's just a statement. So what happens is, in English Bibles, verse 2 is combined with verse 3, which I have down there at the bottom. You are to have no other gods before you. And that's called the first commandment. Okay? But in the Jewish way of thinking, the statement, because they're not commandments, they're just word, they're the words, is just verse 2. And what happens then in Jewish tradition, verse 3 is combined with verse 4 and 5, the commandment not to make idols, and that's the second commandment. And so what happens is they come back into agreement with the numbering on the third commandment. So I hope I haven't confused any of you, but there are the English Bible, or the Christian Bible and the Jewish Bible differ on what the first two commandments are, and then they agree on 3 through 10. So I think I have the third commandment up there. We should look at it. That's, you are not to take, to use lightly the name of Adonai your God, because Adonai will not leave unpunished someone who uses his name lightly. So that, we're going to look at that in a little bit later. But in the first word, which if you could back up one slide there, Dave, God identifies himself as a very special way. He says, I am Adonai your God. And he doesn't say, I was the God who brought you out of slavery in Egypt, but I am, present tense. And this is very important to understand, because when he revealed himself to Moses earlier in the book of Exodus, he did it in a very similar way. And I want to take you back there to the burning bush in chapter 3. And verse 13, Moses said to God, look, when I appear before the people of Israel and say to them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What am I to tell them? And God said to Moses, Eyeh asher eyeh, I am who I am. And he added, here is what you are to say to the people of Israel, Eyeh, I am, has sent me to you. So if we just look at those two verses, Moses asked, what's your name, God? And God said, I am who I am, right? It's pretty clear. Well, a real mystery develops in the next verse. Because in the next verse, verse 15, God said further to Moses, say this to the people of Israel, Yud He Vav He, or as we pronounce Adonai, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Yitzhak, the God of Yaakov, has sent me to you. This is my name forever. This is how I am to be remembered generation after generation. Now that Yud He Vav He, those are four Hebrew letters. And there's no vowels to those letters. And they're known in the Greek as the tetragrammaton, because tetra means four. And they are the name of God that Jewish people don't pronounce. And they don't pronounce it because of the third commandment, because we don't know what the vowels are, and therefore we might be now pronouncing it wrong, and we would be violating the third commandment. We would be taking God's name lightly or saying it wrong. So instead, in Jewish tradition, whenever those four letters appear in the Tanakh, which is all over the place, we substitute the word Adonai or the words Hashem, meaning the name. Hashem, Shem is name, Ha is the name. And in your Bibles, if you have an English Bible, you can look at it carefully. You will find the word Lord in all capital letters. Every time you see the word Lord in all capital letters, it's where the tetragrammatron appeared. And in the Hebrew Bible, it would say Adonai, and that's what we do here, is we say Adonai. So now that you understand what those four letters are, the question is, that's the mystery. Do you see the mystery here? Why did God say to Moses in verse 15, tell Israel, Yud Hey Vav Hey is my name, when in verse 14, he said, tell Israel, Eyeh Asher Eyeh is my name. Do you see something strange there? I mean, to me, that's really strange. They're very different words in Hebrew. It's not like this is just a confusion of the Hebrew language. They're very different. So what is going on here? Why does he say, tell them, I am who I am has sent me? And then later he gives these four letters, and we don't know how to say the four letters. So here's the explanation that I've learned about this, and I think it's very valid, and it's very important to understand. It's the only explanation that makes sense. And that is that the correct vowels for Yud He Vav He are the ones that cause it actually to mean, as a word, God who is. Okay? And those vowels would make it pronounced Yahoveh. Yah is an abbreviation for God. It's used several times in the Tanakh. Hoveh means who is. So Yahoveh would mean, if you put those vowels on the four letters, it would mean God who is. So here's how it all makes sense. When Moses told the people of Israel who sent them, he said, God who is sent me. instead of saying, I am who I am sent me, because that would be referring to him. See what I'm saying? If I came up to you and said, who sent you? And I said to him, I am who I am. You'd say, well, what? You're talking about yourself, right? So instead he said, God who is sent me. And that's what God meant when he said, this is the name that you are to remember. The God who is. And you should be familiar with a little bit of that name. I don't know if any of you recognize it, but what we do a song called Kadosh. Everybody remember the song Kadosh? And in the Hebrew, there's that place in English where it says who was, who is, and who is to come. Well, remember how that goes? V'asher haya, who was, v'hove, who is, v'yavo, and who is to come. So hove means who is, and yah is short for God. So Yahweh is God who is. Now, the reason I think this is so important is that in the Gospels, it's recorded that Yeshua chose to make an issue of this. I counted 11 times when he called himself a title that included I am. Okay? And that's how many are recorded. We don't know how many he said it. He might have said it a lot more times. But here's the titles. I am the Mashiach, the Messiah. I am the Son of the Blessed. I am the bread of life. I am the living bread. I am the light of the world. I am the gate for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection. I am the life. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the vine. Over and over again, he made this use of this I am. And once even in John chapter 8, verse 58, which I have up here, he actually says, I am, without anything else attached to it. He says, before Abraham came into being, I am. So what's he trying to say here? Why did he take this and just, you know, do it all these times? Well, I believe that through using the phrase I am, Yeshua was emphasizing that he was God, alive and present in this world. That's why God said to Moses, this is my name, because he was trying to communicate, I'm here, I'm present, I am alive. And Yeshua was saying, God is present, I am here in this world, alive, it's me. Now, let me see the next verse there. Yeah, in the book of Hebrews, we have this very important principle. Yeshua the Messiah is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So although he's no longer here with us in bodily form, is he still alive? Yes. Is he still present? Yes, he is. He didn't rise from the dead and then die when he got to be a ripe old age. It's been 1980 years, and he's still alive. And Rabbi Scholl confirms this in 1 Corinthians. He's talking about the resurrection, and he says this, so it is with the resurrection of the dead. When the body is sown, it decays. When it is raised, it cannot decay. So Yeshua's raised, resurrected body is not subject to decay. So he's still alive. Now, the reason I felt the Lord saying that I needed to dig into this is that how this fits in with the whole discipling thing is that I think one of the most important things to impart to a disciple is that Yeshua is alive, that he's present. He's present right now. He's present in your hour of need to help, and he's present at all other times. He's ready to give direction in every circumstance. So one of the first tasks of discipling people is to train people to live as if they believed that Yeshua is alive, to train them to call on him, not just in times of great crisis and need and danger, which people do, but as a normal part of their day, to be in contact with him. And I experience this, his presence. Certainly I call on him in times of great needs and crisis and when people ask me to pray for them. But I find that I communicate with him all day about everything that's going on. I turn to him when I can't find my keys, when I can't find my pen, when I need to know what to do next, when I'm tired, when I need strength, when I've got an ache or a pain, I turn to him. When I don't have enough money, and when I see other people in need and I don't know how to help, when I'm afraid, when I'm confused, when I'm hopeless, when I'm rejected, when I'm lonely, when I'm offended, when I'm angry, all those times I have learned to turn to him. And that's so important to impart to the people that you are going to be discipling. And I hope that I can impart some of that to you today. And this is what he says in Matthew 28. Teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And remember what? I will be with you always. Yes, even until the end of the age. So in addition to calling on him all the time, I've disciplined myself to make a practice to come into his presence when I'm not in need of help. This is another whole side of it. Whether big help or small help, by making time to worship and pray every day. And when I do that, not only do I get his help, but I can express my love for him and my passion for him and experience his passionate love for me. That's when I experience the flow. Like I love the example of we are the vine and he is the branch. We're the branches, he's the vine, and like the sap flowing from him to me. I believe it's in that time of being in his presence and worship that it really, really flows. And that's my secret to living in the love that he has for me. And that's my discipling lesson for you guys today. Live in that love. So let's pray. You can clap for the Lord, and then we'll pray. Lord, we thank you for being alive, present, and with us right now. You're here today. You're always with us. And I pray for each person here, Father, that you would show us. Why don't you pray this with me? Show me how to be in contact with you all day long. Open my spiritual eyes. Open my spiritual ears so that I can sense your presence. Teach me to call on you for all my needs, great and small. Help me to have the discipline to come into your presence when I don't have needs, to just worship you and to pray daily. And show me who can disciple me. Some of you are afraid to pray that. Show me who can disciple me. And in what ways? And I humble myself to be taught. And show me who I can disciple. And in what? And may I bear much fruit. Fruit that remains. Amen. Amen.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670, or you can write us at 1326 North Winton Road, Rochester, New York, 14609. Or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service, Saturday mornings at 10 a.m. Complete children's program, interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. We hope you'll visit the featuring Messianic Jewish bookstore located in the lobby of Shema Yisrael. Call for hours. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bagels and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Re'eh Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.